My pleasure as the Dean of the Law School to welcome everyone. We're delighted that you could be here with us this afternoon for the Mirror of Justice lecture. This lecture series began in 1989 to honor Mary under her title, Mirror of Justice. Some of you may know our law school chapel bears the same name, so this lecture has special meaning to us. The lecture series is intended to recognize and support law school faculty whose commitment to the teaching of law and whose scholarship advances our insights towards achieving justice through law in contemporary society. This year, the lecture will be given by Professor A.G. Harmon, a member of our law school faculty, who is well known for his dedication to teaching and scholarship. Professor Harmon will be introduced by our student, Tamer Guillen, who is the president of the St. John Paul II Guild of Catholic Lawyers. Please join me in thanking Tamara and her leadership team for her organization's sponsorship of today's event. Tamara?
Thank you, Dean Andridge, and good afternoon, everyone. I'm Tamara Guillen, and I'm the president of St. John Paul II Guild of Catholic Lawyers. And it's my pleasure today to introduce to you the recipient of this year's Mary Mirror of Justice Award, Professor Harmon. For those of you who only know him as the LSP professor at the school, there is much more. Professor Harmon received his BA from the University of Mississippi, his MA from the University of New Hampshire, his JD from the University of Tennessee, and then that wasn't enough, so he went on to earn his PhD in English here at Catholic University. Professor Harmon has become an integral part of our university's law school community since he joined the faculty. In addition to legal writing, he has taught classes in jurisprudence, law and literature, scholarly writing, remedies, and professional responsibility. The Mirror of Justice Award and lecture is dedicated to the ideals of charity and wisdom of which Professor Harmon emulates. He supports and volunteers numerous organizations, which include the Wounded Warrior Project, Christian Solidarity International, Doctors Without Borders, the Little Sisters of the Poor, St. Jude Children's Research Hospital, and his home parish, the Cathedral of St. Thomas More in Arlington, Virginia. He imparts wisdom to his students through various law school activities. He has become an inspiration to students by heading the Faith in Action Speaker Series, which he brings speakers to address issues involving the intersection of religion and current events. Additionally, he founded the Student Scholar Series. He's also the co-advisor of the Moot Court Board and the Phi Alpha Delta Legal Fraternity. He also serves as the school's representative on the university's Academic Service Committee. Professor Harmon is a prolific writer, for he has received many awards. He has an extensive list of both legal and non-legal works that he has published over the years. Professor Harmon is also a regular contributor at the Pathos, hosting the conversation on faith. Most of all, he has been a supportive ear and a guiding voice for students here at Catholic. We are extremely blessed to have him here with us, sharing his talents and gifts. So, without further ado, please join me in welcoming Professor Harmon.
Thank you. It's a privilege, of course, to be included among those who have received this honor with so great a name, in tribute to Our Lady, Mirror of Justice. To my knowledge, I've not missed one of these lectures in my 17 years here, as I found it to be integral to the school's mission. I'm also fortunate that this honor apparently does not require its recipients to be worthy of the Mirror of Justice name. I'm not warm enough to turn down honors for which I must be worthy, so I accept it. I thank Gil Harley for this distinction and for the courage they show and trying to be both good Catholics and good lawyers in times when it takes true fortitude to do either, let alone both. My career has not been an orthodox one, as I have been both blessed and perhaps cursed with a great many interests. I keep my hand in the field of law, but also in the worlds of art and literature. As I have written in all these areas, when asked to give this talk, it occurred to me that one particular essay of mine, published some years back, transcends not only these fields, but also others, speaking to something fundamental about the human enterprise in general, and about the legal profession in particular. That is, the concept of judging something truly, and of when and how such a thing should come to be. The essay was originally published under the title, The Mass of Virtue. We share an unstated assumption about judgments, about how we assess things and the proper time to do so. This is not a bold claim. It has too great a witness, too large and broad a testimony to deny. From this common perspective comes the woeful stare, the head shake, the sigh-ridden pause. From it is born the painful representation, the assessment that clearly, or so it seems, can scan a person's life and pronounce what looks true of it. In the end, he lost his way. And along with this appraisal, an attending image might arise from the mists of memory, present itself for a moment in all its noble pity, of one who would not hold to the known path, who smiles familiarly before he wanders off again, fading away with a lost portion of our old happiness. In the end, what we are is what we are at the end. All that matters is where we stand at the last point, just before the falling, just before the floating. It all comes down to this, what we look like, sound like, and what direction our faces are turned toward sun or shadow, at the point when there is no longer sun or shadow, but only the direction we have chosen to face. Where are we then? Who are we then at the end? That is what matters, we say. Surely we are born on the court of time, on the line that runs between some certain month, day, year, across a plane of sweat and context that stretches, God willing, by way of a long, long hyphen to a reasonable distance, to another certain month, day, year, at some multiple of 20 from the first. But the question I pose here is whether we are really so like wine upon the day of its uncorking, or so like a tree on the day it is felled. Are we really the bouquet on that day and that day alone? Or the number of rings, count them from the center? And the only one that has meaning is the final. And are we worth trusting? The children that this perspective yields, one dark with a whispered despair, he lost his way. One light with a faltering courage, he found it, forgave all, saw what he should, confessed what he must. Is either justified, boon or burden, in the end? Yes, it would seem, yes, through the God-willing long tally, at some multiple of 20, we draw the line and add, positive or negative. But think about it differently, a way in which you will be no more comforted and no more disturbed than if you hold to the previous view. Think like this. If time is a lie, and eternity the truth, then why is the last thing the only thing? If there is no line or cord, if there is no breach point, no plane that must, however fractionally, be passed over and transformed, if, as physics tells us, there is no edge and no axis to the universe, and if, as St. Augustine says, God is an infinite circle whose center is everywhere and whose circumference is nowhere. And if, say I, age is only an administrative device, then where and when things signify, where and when virtue is attained, is more complex. Then our renunciations, our recantings and newfound creeds are not a matter of time, but a matter of substance. After all, a man who was once strong, but who has lost the will or the belief that exercise will do him good, nevertheless retains that residual vigor, that core of power that allows him, if not to lift what he once could, still to lift what he can, which might be more than hundreds of men who are convinced he is mistaken in his faithlessness and are convicted of the good he has forsworn. It is no use saying that such a man is no longer strong. He is only not as strong as he was. What wanes is not gone. A fading light is still a light. A stone abraded by wind and water remains itself. And so, perhaps, to goodness, virtue, faith still live in the sweepings and drags. Virtue motivates even its palsy. Love that once was strength and speed may become a wasted space, perhaps a bruise or torpor, but still is felt and still can surprise with flashes of its nature. Its nature is not changed by flux, nor is it changed by disavowal of its possessor. A quote, good heretic, is not as oxymoronic as we might think, if we think like this. I bring certain witnesses. First, Pierre Morin, the old and near forgotten novelist in Graham Greene's short story entitled A Visit to Morin. In the story, the narrator is a skeptical man who as a youth had been drawn to the author's strange, enigmatic works. While orthodox in their overall tenor, the novels nevertheless contain something wild, something gamey, as Morin himself puts it, in their vehicle. They portray believers in a dogma that is sometimes, and at that time, had already been dismissed as a preposterous old fancy. Morin's stories teased out the extremes of this outrageous view, the assumption of a certain version, for example, and pushed them either to their absurd conclusions or reduced them to their legal minimums. About this was the smell of the Jansenist, but one nevertheless committed to the core of his faith. The narrator, on a lonely Christmas trip to France, seeks out Morin in a midnight mass. Christmas Eve. There, in the crystalline cold of the village church, lit by candles that burn straight as icicles in the frost, the man easily finds his author among the shuffling, silent coats and gloves, as Morin himself is the only other person in the crowd who abstains from communion. The others all seek out their God, who travels along the altar rail to be placed upon their tongues, while the two protagonists in the story hang back. Afterwards, in Morin's house, where the narrator is invited for a glass of Christmas Eve wine, he learns that the author has not in fact communed for 20 years. Like a character in his own novels, Morin stands at the end of a long slip of sand, a finger of ground from which he cannot retreat or advance, unable to believe any longer, but equally unable to lose his faith. He had excommunicated himself upon the taking of a mistress and would not profane the confessional booth by seeking an absolution for that which he had no intention to amend. But with the loss of the sacraments, he says, he lost his belief in God and his son, and his angels, and his saints, a loss that came just as the church had wanted it would. And in this loss is the paradox of his convictions. He no longer believes in the holy objects of faith because he has cut himself off from what feeds that belief. He has lost his belief just as the tenet of his faith foretold. The faith is so precious to him that he dares not attempt communion. He says, I have a fear that belief in the objects might not return with the Holy Host and the Blessed Blood. So, trapped there, in this cold, dark night of the great theophany, he waits, both faithful and faithless, at the same time an apostate, and yet a mystical communicant, and that which he loves both too much and too little to risk. And what is such a man? In the end, at the end. The story stops there, and Morin himself is left in the quandary, as frozen as the night. Both things are true of him, what he was and what he is now, but which matters? What are we witnessing in this moment that Green portrays, a dawn or a dusk? Life or loss? Do what Morin was and what he is make sense independently of each other? You could as easily look back upon Morin, the renaissance of his belief, at the ancient Christmas night of his faith, and charge that first flowering with naivete, with a kind of childish wish fulfillment that shows itself a fraud when age and circumstance present themselves. You could as easily blackwash what was, make it untrue, as you could take this final despair as definitive of his being. But that is another assumption we have in common. We trust despair. We give full credit to his sincerity. It is always hope that we call false. It is faith we stop blind and shallow. Why didn't say he lost his faith? Why not go further and say he never tried and found it to begin with? That is sometimes the case, of course, seeds that fall on rocky ground. But they are not the subject here. The subject here is those who, like Moran, were not dupes of fashion or fools of a motley trust. Those who, even if they never nurture a dogma or find shape in a creed, once, for however short or long, fell upon rich ground, took root, flourished in courage and kindness. It is no surprise that they still weather winter and drought and flood, and from what we see of them and from what they see of themselves are haggard in the end, despite that which sustains them. There's nothing to belie their wan autumn cast, especially when it is the last we see. For who can speak of spring with such a sight, of green when all is brown, of all things new when the end is dressed with dying? What good is the talk of Sunday morning when Friday follows dusk toned Friday? But that is the folly of the last, or of paying too much close attention to it. For the last remains within the tyranny of time, a despot that holds the head within its grasp and will not let the eyes avert to aught but that which it shows them, the final thing. It is the calendar, the clock, the last grain of sand dropping through the glass that matters, time says. But if the imaginative rebellion suggested here is undertaken, if the hands are shaken off and the eyes closed, there is this alternate view, not so taken with the calendar, more trusting of the scales, not bound to the sight of the last thing in its assessment, but to the things sheer weight, its magnitude, its mass. Witness a physical hypothesis from the realm of physics. Einstein's general theory of relativity says that space-time is like a sheet pulled taut. If something heavy is placed upon the sheet, like the sun, it dimples the surface, pulling it down, displacing the fabric according to its mass. A lighter object, like the earth, if thrown onto the sheet, would be pulled towards the larger because of its sheer great weight. Gravitational force acts in this way, drawing the smaller object into orbit around the larger, not because of any elective attraction between the two masses, but because of the depression the larger makes in the fabric of space. In this way, matter warps time. So, if temporal and spatial concepts are subject to the force of gravity and motion, then does not a different metaphor have a claim to our concepts of goodness? Is the heft of the thing not worth as much as its station? If essence takes the place of mass, and the degree of extant virtue contributes to the fullness or richness of that essence, it displaces more of the moral universe and it has more consequence on it than the accident of disposition or placement in time. Time and space end at the speed of light, the great Einstein said, but weight imploding upon itself and the black hole of awful and awesome lore pulls all within it, even time and space. So does not the pull of the virtues mass create a force that draws others to it, that begets their hopes and prayers despite the place where it rests at the last? If this is so, then the important question is not, where were you last? But where have you been? Witness the great discovery in visual representation. Perspective, yielded from times that saw a monumental sea change in philosophical and cultural worldview, the Renaissance, perspective plumbed depths and distances from what had only been flat before, only linear, only pasted on. However lovely the renderings of medieval times, they could not pull upon the human imagination or heart with anywhere near the same intensity as sculpture. Not until the breakthrough that allowed painting objects to gain weight permitted figures to grow fat and round. In Caravaggio's Deposition of the Christ, 1604, the five Good Friday mourners are arranged in a sliding diagonal above the clean, heavily muscled body of a god who is deigned to die. The perspective of the viewer is not allowed to wander about the surface. The sight line is drawn with implacable power to the absolute center of the painting, Christ's hand that lies graceful and relaxed upon his stomach. From this place and the work's core, the eye can find the points in a well-known story, the deposition. The hands of Mary Cleopas are raised in grief-struck supplication. The other hand of Christ himself lies at the end of an arm that drapes down from the body towards the sepulchre as though touching the waters of the dark pool, like the death-life paradox of the baptismal bath. But never is the commanding center, the indomitable gravity of the painting, lost to any point in the narrative, not even to this greatest of final acts. Instead, all the elements in the work speak of the crush of weight, the profundity of the mass that pulls everything into it, including the mourners themselves, who are dragged down under the heft of their God as they too will enter the tomb with him, in less control of what they seemingly handle than the corpse himself. Even the cross of cloth that symbolically lies behind the body, a post of John the Evangelist's red tunic, and a crossbar made of the Christ's white shroud, collapses and shrinks into the aperture. Nothing in the painting can escape the force, the pull of this weight ordered about this center, and yet nothing in the work, despite the part of the salvation story exhibited here, the last act, speaks of endings. All is triumph and control within the command of the one who is mourned. No small part of this masterwork's victory lies in the paradox that Jesus, represented here, seems as much the Christ of the Transfiguration, resplendent and powerful, as he does the Christ of the Crucifixion. The savage death, the wounds barely mark the flesh. So, is this an ending or a beginning? And is what is shown here any more definitional of the Christian God than an earlier point in his earthly walk? That such a point presents a larger question. Is the Christian God's whole life not meant to be seen as a sacrifice? How is his birth, the emptying of all that was or ever will be, into the limiting vessel of only what we ourselves have been, not a lifelong 33-year crucifixion? If he never ceases to be himself, then is not the last act, though the greatest expression of who he is, more teaching device, a spectacle for the beholder's understanding, than it is definitive of the teacher himself? If he is, at all points, and eternally defined by sacrificial love, is as much that in the manger as he is on the cross. The poet T.S. Eliot's Journey of the Magi uses this idea. The key to the dramatic monologue is expressed in these very terms. In the poem, the world-weary narrator, the wise man in old age, speaks of what he saw long ago in the Nativity. But he's confused as to whether what he was witnessed was a birth or a death. Considering the effect of what he once beheld in the stable, he says, and says for us all, I should be glad of another death. Death and birth, beginnings and endings have become all the same because of the nature of what has happened and still happens. As gravity warps time. Finally, witness a man I knew. A man who's dead now, whose end has come. Larger in stature, in ability, and in heart, and unfortunately in appetites than anyone I've ever known, he arrived on my parents' farm when I was still a boy. He had been brought to stack hay, driven there because he had no car. His sockless feet were crammed into split, cracked shoes, the soles of which flapped against the leather uppers as he walked. In the dead of winter, he wore only a pair of white coveralls with the sleeves cut out. My father bought him a coat and all the clothes he would wear for the next 70 years. Who knows his age then? Who knows where along the hyphen that stretched between the numbers of his life? I do not want to know. As such, the commitment distracts me from the way I remember him and what I remember most, a man marked by what he could do. Number one, clip the side of a hill while standing up on a tractor. His mammoth weight bounced on the uphill leg as he braved the monstrous machines turning over and crushing him with its cold steel load. He did not blink at that. Number two, throw bales of hay to the top of a stack, whether on a wagon or in a loft, so often and so fast the stackers above him grew angry and fearful of his power and his amused use of it. He laughed at that. Number three, crawl beneath a church on a day colder than collective memory, armed with an acetylene torch so as to unfreeze frozen pipes a Saturday in January. His day off from work, and all because it was my sister's wedding. Only he could come. Only he would come. He accepted that. Number four, recite with encyclopedic accuracy to a young boy the history of boxing in America. Number five, lift the front end of a car on a bet. Number six, eat an entire two-legger cake by holding it in one hand like a cookie. Number seven, laugh a room's spirits to the rafters. This man would come to own a house, a car, to manage a team of workers at the hospital where my father got him a job. And he would come to lose all of those things, to find his way to jail. Too often, sometimes unfairly, most times not. To feed himself with narcotics for the last 20 years of his life until he faded into a slightness that stole all but the weight of his eyes. At the last, he was committed to the obscurity of a nursing home, an obscene joke he had played upon himself, like an old bull staked inside a dog pen. And so his end spoke of tragedy, and I, like any other, am drawn to it. But I must wrest myself free, because there is a thing that is truer of him, that weighs heavier than his end, that gives the right perspective, that he did not get many chances and perhaps squandered the ones he was allowed, is nothing when balanced against this mass. For he was raised by his mother, who died at some point that I cannot locate on either his line or my own. Still, I remember the effect of his loss, the loss of that love. A man as large as a doorway sitting within the confines of my parents' car as they had come to console him. He did not cry, but his face was wet with grief, as my own mother told him of higher things, of other lives, of promises offered for the taking. He had said, and to my knowledge, continued to say that he did not believe in anything. A fact that in the Deep South at that time was a moment of great amazement. But on that day, he listened. And after that day, he brought my mother something that had always been in the shack in which he grew up. A thing of sea blue glass, a jug of some sort, as big around as a wash tub with a fluted neck and a cut glass stopper. Its use he could not imagine, its value was unknown, but he knew it was good. It was the best thing that he had, and he gave it to my parents for what they had bothered to do. At some further point along the line, his appetites got the better of him, and the crime of what he did to himself robbed him of all that he had won. And at the place where his life and ours could no longer transact, he discreetly slipped away. He would not call anymore for work, although we would hear from him from time to time, and on odd occasions, his paths would cross ours. But in his squanderings, his prodigalities, which must have been desperate and involved him with desperate men, he never asked for anything, and more importantly, never turned upon the people of his former life. He could have, but he did not. And for that reason, he was never feared. There were many people for my parents to be on guard about, laborers over the years of dubious character and suspicious history, ones to be wary of and go down and lock the gate against, but not him. Never did we ask whether he would come to steal or threaten. It was understood he would not do such a thing, because he would remember. He had bestowed a gift and would not take it back. It sat in a place of honor, the blue glass vessel. I think at what time peacock feathers sprouted from its top, their iridescent blues and greens capturing the color of the glass itself. And what I believe of this man now is captured within the testament of his gesture. Its weight belies the time that followed it. Despite the relentless weather of drink and drugs, not even the accumulation of those things could wear away the substance of a man who was better than his end. We are mostly lost to ourselves. We are the subject of our own deepest bafflement. We do not know our motivations for good or ill. I venture to say that we are often unsure of what we believe. At moments, feverish with our devotions, at moments, stripped clean of them. Within the cycle of one sun and one moon, the altar can become a table, the candle, deficient light, the sacraments, superstitions, prayer, a mutter trap behind the teeth. But what then? What does that prove? Does that mean that they were never more to us? Is it true that we are made hypocrites by our final doubts, by our trailing despair? Do they give the lie to what once was simply because they follow what once was in time? How much of a being heavy with virtue is eroded by its final disposition? And conversely, are we so sure of what we are? And here is the disquieting part. So triumphant in what we believe and what we have taken up so quickly when it is not habit but novelty. Then again, perhaps love and its children, faith and hope, are born more easily than they are killed and are hardier than even we may know. They never seem sickly at their birth. On the contrary, they are often so full, round, heavy, and lively that they must be tempered with rubrics, with the shape and form of dogma. They must be ordered so that they can grow, which is why we have the church. But their reality is proven by their sincerity, their heft, not by their birth date. And so they should be assessed in the last. That would square with the merciful God, who can see better than we and could hear more than we have spoken. Our groanings, unintelligible to us, are said to be intelligible to him, coming from places we do not even know we had been. Despite the last complexion of what they seem, despite the last testament of the one who speaks for them, they live on in the deep loam, the fertile mass, the soul of souls. They last despite their own forswearing and love on in a rich, wet hollow of a wound past knowing, and in a place long before endings. They weigh too much to forget. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Harmon. That was profound, and I'm almost afraid to talk for breaking the spell. But I'm sure all of us have different things that we can take away from that. For me, I really appreciate how the pursuit of peace is emphasized through and protected and extended through combination and integration of faith and justice. And that's what this award stands for. And thank you very much for exemplifying
that.
Thank
you so much.